Hey guys, Matt Robinson here, founder of the Professional Investors Guild, and I am coming to you live from my home office because obviously I am sheltering in place and self-quarantining and all of that great stuff. And so hopefully you guys are doing well. I miss all of you, and I hope this video finds you guys healthy and strong and avoiding germs and bathing in hand sanitizer and all that really great stuff. And hopefully you are enjoying some of these videos we've been putting out. Certainly this one, I was shocked. You know, I never really saw my video setup as being all that sophisticated and or my lighting being all that great until I started watching all these people do videos from their home on the news broadcasts, and I'm just shocked and amazed at what people will do on a national television broadcast. So now I'm feeling a little bit better about my videos. But anyway, I hope you guys are doing fantastic. If you don't know already, if you haven't seen it online, I want to make sure that you are aware that we have a webinar coming up on April 14th. It's going to be at 7 p.m. and it is specifically about COVID-19 and real estate, the things that you need to know. You can register for that webinar at the link below or just by going to piginvestor.com. That's piginvestor.com. Now, a lot of that is going to be, we're going to be talking about mindset, about just kind of staying calm, taking a deep breath, understanding how to invest if there is an economic downturn or a contraction, kind of what you can do during these times as of right now to kind of position yourself and prepare yourself to be able to prosper in these times of uncertainty. And so a lot of that webinar is going to be about that. But because it is, you know, a ways off, a little bit over a week now, depending on when you're watching this video, one of the things I wanted to address were some of these time-sensitive issues. And so I just wanted to shoot you a quick video so that you guys were aware of these things if you haven't already researched them for yourself. So again, just recently, if you hadn't heard, both Alabama and Florida have put stay-at-home orders or shelter in place orders where you can only operate and act with what they call essential businesses. So many of you may already be aware of that or have seen other posts from other real estate investors or from us on the PIG webpage. But I just want to make sure that you understand that within that whole thing right now, as far as I'm concerned, as far as I know, construction services are still deemed essential. I spoke to a contractor the other day. He's still doing business. So if you're trying to wrap up or finish some rehabs, renovation projects, maybe get a rental property done and online, you should be able to still do that. The other thing, obviously, that's critically important is that closing companies, title companies, settlement services are still considered essential as well. So if you have a closing that's supposed to be closing here soon, you should be able to do that. If you're doing new business, I actually have a few closings supposed to be tomorrow. All of those seem to be moving forward. You know, title companies have been doing mail out closings for years now. So this is nothing out of the ordinary. They can close a transaction without people actually being in the same room together. You know, obviously technology, these videos, our webinars we're doing this month, there's been a lot of technological advances in the last decade or so that allow us to continue to do business and operate in a lot of ways. Of course, there's some things we can't do, but a lot of things we can. So first I want to let you know about that. That's kind of recent news, but for those of you who have closings in place, they shouldn't be placed in jeopardy because of that. The second thing is that, you know, just recently we passed the first of the month. And so many of you, hopefully we're still, if you have rental properties, we're still able to get your tenants to pay. They were still able to do that. Hopefully many of them still have jobs. If they don't, I just wanted to address a couple of issues in regards to that, because I've seen some posts online that, you know, sometimes it's good advice, sometimes it might be a little disturbing, some of the things that I see. But I think the biggest thing, and a lot of people have backed me up on this, and some of our members commented on a post that I recently put on the Facebook page, that, you know, one of the keys to this time right now really is about communication with your tenants, right? And communication as in not being a jerk, okay? This is not a time, this is a national crisis. And whether or not you think it's a big deal or not, hopefully by now people understand that this is a serious issue and it is not some, you know, conspiracy generated by the media or by the government to take away your rights. If you're still in that camp, you know, God bless you. But this is obviously a serious pandemic and people are scared, right? And so it's, first of all, you got to go into that understanding that and just be somebody who's going to communicate and communicate with kindness as it pertains to your tenants. They also are scared, right? And so if they haven't lost their job, I'm not saying let tenants take advantage of you. If they haven't lost their job, job, they have money. Obviously, if they're going to tell you they've lost their job, they should be able to document that in some way. But if they have, I think the best thing, the best course of action is to really help guide them towards the resources that are available to them. Of course, unemployment has been made available for up to 4 months. And also they're going to get a government stimulus check here, you know, in a few weeks. Most of them will. So all of them should be able to pay their rent. So I think the one thing you got to keep in mind is that most tenants, especially in the lower socioeconomic kind of area, they think that all of their landlords are rich and that they could be fine if they miss a rent payment. And so as long as you communicate them that you're a normal person with bills and have to pay your mortgage payment and all those kind of things, as long as you communicate and help them out, typically, I think if you're personable, this is a relationship business, you understand that it's not, real estate isn't just about buildings and houses and stuff like that, but it's about people as well. And as long as you communicate with kindness, I think most of us are going to be able to work this situation out. Hopefully this will be remedied within a few months, a couple months, and I think most of us are going to be covered through unemployment, through some of the other programs I'm going to talk about here in just a second. And so I think the government's done as much as they can to try to keep the economy rolling, and most of your tenants should be able to pay. But if you feel like there's some kind of conspiracy and a lot of them are getting together trying to say, you know, we're going to put it to the man and not pay our rent, then certainly in kindness, explain to them what that might mean to them in the future. And, you know, once moratoriums on evictions are lifted, that they would, you don't have to make it as a threat, but if they're not able to pay their rent, even though they have the means, they would eventually be evicted. One thing I want you to keep in mind, though, there's a great Bible story. And again, you don't have to be a Christian or a believer to learn something from this story. But there's a Bible story where there's a gentleman who owes this massive debt to a king or somebody. I can't remember the exact story, but he goes and he owes all this money to I believe it's a ruler. And when he goes to that, the ruler forgives this massive debt. Like he owes a ton of money to this guy and he forgives the debt. And he starts walking home and he's heading home after having this massive debt paid for him. And he sees somebody who owes him far less money than he owed this ruler. And he starts just going off and, you know, just treating this guy, belittling this guy, treating him poorly, demanding that he pay him, even though he had just been forgiven something massive. And so I just keep that in mind because, you know, depending how long this lingers on and depending on what situation you might be in financially, if you didn't save and put reserves aside, like I've been teaching for years now, if you did over leverage, like I've been teaching you not to do for years now, if you did put yourself in that position, understand that you're probably going to be going to your lender and asking for some forbearance or for some extensions on your mortgage payments, some deferments on those things. You're going to be seeking some relief from some of your creditors. Most of you are going to be going to the SBA about some of these things I'm going to talk about in just a second and asking for government help. So if you're going to do that, let's not be hypocrites and then treat people poorly that are our tenants because they need some assistance or because they might be struggling right now. So I think if we all work together and again, treat one another with love and kindness during what is certainly a challenging time and a time of uncertainty of that one thing for certain, I just make sure it's clear in this video, we will get through this, okay? And so no matter how, I've been through these types of events before, obviously nothing exactly like this, but been through downturns, been through tragic things, been through situations locally, personally, and we always get through it. Okay, we always have and we always will. And this isn't the bubonic plague. It is serious, but it is not going to wipe out half the population. They're going to find some cures. They're going to find some things that they can do to fix this. They're going to create a vaccine. And eventually, this is going to be something that is a story that we remember 5 years from now. When you're in the middle of it, obviously, that's the toughest time. Just take a deep breath, stay calm, treat everybody with kindness. We are going to get through it. And I think if you want to be proud at the end of this, how you treated each other, right? Because we can all be kind and we can all do things good for each other when everything's going right. The true measure of a man or a woman is how they treat one another in times of distress and times of challenge. So just keep that in mind as you move forward. The third time-sensitive thing that I want to address, which just before we get to the webinar, there'll be many more things I'll cover, and we'll go way more in depth on the webinar on the 14th. Again, you can register at piginvestor.com if you haven't done so already. But the other thing I want to address is just about these government programs, right? So there's two main ones. Now, of course, if you are an independent contractor and or in the what they call the gig industry or other things, you can get unemployment. You've never been able to do that before. So depending on your business, if you've seen a loss in income, you can still file for unemployment. But there's two main things for business owners, and you've probably heard of some of them, but if you're not familiar with them, I just want to make sure you know some of the timelines, because we are talking about some things that are time sensitive. The first thing is the EIDL, which is the Economic Injury Disaster Loans. These are specifically, and I've already seen some of you post that you've applied for them, but these are specifically through the SBA. And the one good thing about that is if you have a true documented economic loss, which I know many of you do. Now, if you don't, you shouldn't really be applying for this. But if you have a true documented economic loss, it's not just time to go get free money. But if you are facing, if you've seen your business contract, there were deals that didn't close that should have, you could apply for this loan. It's up to $2 million. Of course, you do have to qualify for this one. And it's specifically through the SBA, right? So you don't go to a bank for this. You actually go straight to SBA.gov and apply for that loan. If you do that, they have $10,000 in kind of a grant and economic assistance, kind of emergency assistance that you get to keep and not pay back even if you don't go forward with their loan. Okay. Obviously, you want to research that. You want to ask some questions. You want to dig a little deeper. Actually, Bill Allen just posted some really deep dive he did into that on our Facebook page. So if you're a PIG member, you can go and look at that. There's some other stuff online as well. But you definitely want to research that. That's specifically through the SBA. Now, understand, that's through the Department of the Treasury. And if you were to ever default on that loan, trust me, they're going to come after everything you have for the rest of your life until they get it, including taking any tax returns you may have, etc. So think twice, make sure it's something, if you go the lending route with them, make sure it's something you think through the ramifications and don't just freak out because you're in hysteria. You know, be calm, make sure you read the fine print and all of these things before you just make a stressed out kind of decision, okay? So again, take a deep breath. Be slow to make these decisions as far as thinking through them. And then, of course, take action if there are deadlines and timelines that you need to operate under. The second thing besides the EIDL is the PPP through the CARES Act. The government's big with their acronyms. But if you're not familiar with the PPP, that is just simply the payroll protection plan that they're making available. Again, this was part of that $350 billion. And that is allows you to take your average payroll. It does also include the amount that you paid independent contractors in your payroll over the last 12 months. You get to take 2.5 times the average monthly payroll, and they will extend that to you basically in the form of a loan initially, but as long as you only use it for the things they say you can use it for, which is rent for your business and payroll to keep your employees, and you have to keep all your employees or at least a percentage of them. Again, I can't get into all the details in this video. We'll talk a little bit more about it on the 14th or dive into Bill Allen's video that he posted on our Facebook page. But again, this money is available for you. The big thing, the reason why I want to get this video out is that if you haven't seen or you weren't familiar with it or you're not a part of another, you know, list that's posting stuff about this, is that that is supposed to begin on April the 3rd. Now, depending on what day you're actually watching this video, it'll be online for a while. That's supposed to start on the 3rd. But for those of you that are watching this now, I'm filming this on the 2nd, understand that I just got a thing that popped up on my phone, an alert on my phone from CNBC stating that though it's supposed to begin tomorrow, they're actually, JP Morgan Chase just came out and said, sent an email to all their clients and said, we're not ready to do it. The government hasn't given us enough information, and so it looks like it's just too much red tape and chaos, which is normally the case with the government, and so it may not happen on the 3rd. So while I thought this was time sensitive and I want to make sure I got the video out to you, it may still get delayed. So as of right now, on April 3rd, this was the way it was supposed to be set up, on April 3rd, sole proprietors and small business owners could start making application. And again, this is through, not directly through the SBA. The PPP is actually through SBA lenders. So like JP Morgan Chase or Wells Fargo or other banks out there, Huntington Bank, that do SBA loans. Okay. So if you don't already have an SBA lender, you would want to contact one, find one. And even though they're not starting officially until the 3rd, or if it gets delayed, maybe a little later than that, you still want to have contacted them and tried to get in line. There's $350 billion. That may go very, very quickly, and it's first come, first serve. Now, they've talked about a phase 4. They may put some more money out there, but, you know, who really knows? So you want to, the reason why this is time sensitive is that you really need to contact an SBA lender and get in line, get on their list, so you can be notified as soon as this officially launches. Again, supposed to be the 3rd for small business owners and sole proprietors, and it was supposed to be on April 10th. For independent contractors and those who are self-employed, okay? So again, a lot of things are changing very quickly. So it was supposed to launch on that date. It may get delayed. Certainly pay attention to SBA.gov. search online, pay attention to the pig page. A lot of people are posting things, keeping people updated about that. But because it was time sensitive, I just wanted to get that information out to you. Again, as things change, we'll try to post further videos or things on the Facebook page. But also make sure you do join us on April 14th, because not only will we be talking about these programs that are available and the different changes and going deeper into them, but we'll also be talking just overview, some of the things that I learned going through a real estate market crash in 07, 08, and 09, the ways we were able to tweak our business. I am, you know, a bit of a success story in terms of I didn't, you know, totally crash and burn. I was able to find new strategies and new ways and kind of shift with the market. So those were challenging times too. So I've been there. I've done that. Many of you know I made massive changes in the way I handled finances from that situation, things I learned. I've been very secure and safe through that. But anyway, I'm going to guide you guys through that and help you get through this transitional time, prepare yourself, position yourself, learn some lessons, and make sure that you come out way better on the other side. If you have any questions, feel free to post them in the comments below. Shoot me an email at matt@professionalinvestorsguild.com, but be sure that you get registered for the webinar so we can talk to you then as well. April 14th at 7 p.m., but you can register right now by going to piginvestor.com. Again, that's piginvestor.com, and I look forward to seeing you all there.